Hey everybody, welcome back to Bengineering, and here we're at the Electrotechnical Service Center of Bengineering Ranch, and I got the Caroute N160 trolling motor that I got. This was my first sponsored video right here. They sold this to me for super cheap, basically shipping, to test it out and give them a YouTube video, because I happen to be one of the few people who already had a 48-volt DC boat. Anyways, this thing is not working right anymore, and we are going to repair it. I've got all the parts. I've got the instruction manual. I've got materials. And we're going to first go over the symptomology, what went wrong with this thing. And then we're going to do the repair. And it'll be interesting because it's not going to be exactly the way that Caroute wants me to repair it. Just because we're going to kind of change the thermal dissipation configuration in here a little bit. I couldn't buy exactly the same silicone products they use for their motor. So anyways, I'm going to get this thing hooked up, get my power supply turned on, and we will briefly cover what goes wrong with it. In fact, let's see, I think actually it is ready to go. So linear regulated supply, got it set for 32 volts, and some funny things happen. Constant current mode is set for 5 amps, so that should be plenty. Now, you note that when I powered it up, you didn't hear the song from the motor, right? The motor should play a kind of a short tune. It doesn't have a speaker or anything. I think it just pulses some stator, high frequency stator current, a very low current. The motor doesn't even move when you do that. Oh, let's see. Let's try that. There. You heard that broken song right there? Let's do it again. Let's open the breaker and close it again. Yeah, that's broken. So, let's turn our voltage to 24 and power it up. There's the healthy sound. When you get all of those tones in the right order, then you're ready for operation. So this motor is mostly designed to operate at 48 volt DC. It doesn't work at 48 volt DC. It just won't even power on properly. So let's increase the voltage and I'll show you what happens. So it's speeding up. Oops. That's a fail there. And here's the weird thing. Huh. Fascinating. Anyways, this is a brushless three-phase permanent magnet motor, direct drive, right out the back, unlike Torquedo that has a planetary gear reduction system in here. So super low pitch propeller. Definitely when I tested it, I saw some issues with every once in a while the motor controller would kind of misfire and you'd get kind of a punch or a hesitation, like a single RPM was lost, but it worked for the most part. It worked really well and it drove my little boat great. So now this thing was installed on a much bigger boat and ran at a higher load, however, within spec, about 2400 watts. And it started crapping out on me while I was on the water. And so then I stopped using it on the water. I started testing it onshore and just had these problems powering it up, and I didn't trust it anymore. So anyways, that is the problem. It's not perfectly reliable on its shutdown at 32 volts, but things do go wrong with it. And if I make some small adjustments to the throttle, especially if I start and stop this motor, it fails to restart like this right here. And it's not dead, it's just unresponsive. So if I do something, sometimes it starts working again. Anyways, That's unacceptable for waterway use. This is supposed to be a primary propulsion for one of my boats, a bigger boat than Wild Thing, and backup propulsion if I need it, if I'm out using a gas motor. So anyways, we're going to take it apart and figure out what's going wrong. I've got a bunch of great new parts here. So here's all my new parts, straight from China, from Caroute. And look, props to Caroute. They provide really good tech support, and they shipped me a bunch of parts. I've bought a new in-motor, in the nacelle. It's all the way back here, control board, because that's the only part of active electronics in the motor. The rest is just permanent magnets and a stator and bearings and seals. So they sold me this for $200, got it shipped here from China. Jane at Caroute, always super helpful. $200 is what I bought the motor for about 5 years ago. Impressed to see NSK Japanese bearings. That's great stuff. They threw in a free set of seals, new shaft seals. It's got dual shaft seals. That's kind of neat. New O-rings for the motor body. This is the thrust washer that we'll be putting in. Thrust bearing. So ball bearing with a brass carrier keeper. And then our two NSK bearings that are unpacked. And then there's a shield for the seals and a snap ring to hold it all together. And of course, we'll schmoo it up with green grease, the best marine grease I can find. I don't know, maybe calcium sulfate, but I've got a pile of green grease for everything around here, so I think that's what we're going to use. And so the new PCB, the old one I'm going to have to dig out. It's completely potted with a thermal silicone product, so we'll dig it out. This is an interesting thing. It's super, super compact, and there's some kind of add-on board here. Don't know what the story is with this, but we'll see if the old board has it on there and what the new one is like. Super simple, anti-vibe nut, split washer, big stainless washer, nothing to it, super low pitch propeller, pull our shear pin out, here's the, I guess what they call the martyr anode, sacrificial anode. I don't think we really have to remove that, but we do have a shield right here over the dual shaft seals. We'll get to that later. We're gonna strip apart the motor casing here. Help it come apart without dropping anything. And then we will expose the inner space of the motor. There we go, it's already apart. Okay, so here's a slightly better view. Got the nose cone removed. Got the main stator and rotor assembly, which is firmly magneted together. We got our leads coming down from the motor that separate with these high current banana connectors. They're like RC connectors. And then we have our circuit board potted in place here, and it's retained in two spots. And this is two layers of potting. One goes underneath the circuit board and one goes on top. So anyways, I can see some capacitors poking out here. There is some kind of switch thing here that's not present on the old one. We'll see what in the world that is. And I don't know, supposedly this is a high performance thermal silicone transfer, heat transfer product. It really doesn't have very good specs. It's something like 0.5 watts per cm squared, whatever. And anyways, I bought a thermal transfer pad for PC component parts. It's got about 20 times better performance. So we'll be putting that in underneath the board, and then we'll be putting a flexible epoxy coating on top of the board to pot it in place. So this is pretty soft, but we will have to carve this out of here. I won't bore you with those details. We'll skip ahead here. Okay, so we got most of the stuff out of the way. I've taken a knife and I've cut around the outer circumference and the inner circumference of the potting, which isn't very deep, just to give myself a little extra room. And I'm just gonna wrap one of these wires around a screwdriver shaft and pull up on this circuit board, and it comes right out. Brilliant. Okay, so we've got this open. Circuit board is out. Super interesting here. So, first thought, there is a shit interface here. This is the layer of silicone that seeped down. This is the second application of thermal silicone. Okay. Well, maybe you missed the unboxing here. Stupid iPhone kept cutting out overheating. That's great. iPhone 13. Got the board out. I pulled all of the thermal silicone off of this thing. And it is quite a bit different than the old board, than the new board. So we've got this thing here. I'm feeling generous. Maybe I'll get some part breakdown on components on this board. Anyways, this looks like some kind of temperature switch that's glued onto the PCB to shut down during an overheat condition. That would certainly be a suspect for me, considering like the total shutdown and restart of the board. Maybe it's become too sensitive to voltage. It's really kind of haphazardly installed here too, with the wires just kind of landing on the PCB. Anyways, little connectors for the potentiometer for forward, neutral, reverse input. So just you got the brains here and then the power components on the other side. And definitely different MOSFETs than the old system, than the new board. 7749, I don't know. Anyways, I'll look at that later. Really just want to get this thing repaired and get the boat back in the water. So I'll continue on stripping out the rest of the epoxy in here and get it ready for a thermal compound. Thermal pad, and then we got to figure out a way to keep this board firmly planted against the thermal pad that we're going to install in here while it's being potted, and then hopefully that potting does a good job at maintaining some pressure on the board to keep it firmly adhered to its thermal transfer pad. Well, that came out nice and easy. It just peeled out like a piece of paint. And if they poured it, it's definitely not a uniform thickness. So I wouldn't count on that machined face at the end of the housing. It definitely is, if gravity set this to a perfectly flat profile, the inner face is slightly lower than the outer edge. So it's got a bit of a taper to it. Anyways, I have a 0.5 millimeter thermal pad, which should be kind of similar profile to this. And doesn't need to make contact with the whole board. It really just needs to make contact with these semiconductors, and they have quite a bit of standoff here. It's actually considerably more than the old boards of very low profile MOSFETs, although these had like tin or copper heat spreaders on them, and these are definitely plastic cases. So anyways, different material. Couldn't find any revision marks or dates on the old PCB, but the new one is a YD6.2_DRV 2021-11-16, so it seems like it's pretty recent. Anyways, I hope it's awesome. Okay, so before we go through the finesse of reinstalling the circuit board, we're going to knock out some of these old parts. So we knock it about a little bit. So the stainless steel shield is sacrificial. And of course, we've got new sealers, according to the manual, new seals. So I'm going to pull these out. And these are interesting. Their orientation is opposite. So insides of the seals face each other on the dual seals. That is interesting. Kind of like a Mott Energy. It's a 18. It's a 17-18 that I have in my other boat that had a oil seal on the shaft, even though it had no oil in it. And interestingly, the oil seal faced in to the motor, so the sealing lip that would hold the oil in was facing the outside. And the reason for that, according to Mott Energy and Thunderstruck, was a application in a differential where the entire NEMA 143T flange of the motor was exposed to a gear lube. And so the purpose of that seal was to keep gear lube out of the motor. Fascinating. Anyways, I'm gonna get my snap ring pliers, knock that bearing out. Looks like these are originally, it's got the old NSKs in there, and I've got brand new NSKs to put in. So sure, why not? We'll throw them in because we got them. Okay, back. Sorry, I got a little carried away with the brutal efficiency of repairing things without making a YouTube video. You're welcome. And already knocked the old bearing out. It came out super easy. Just pushed on it and it slid out once the snap ring was out of the way. Okay, engaging safety squints again. Little bit of potential energy bound up in there. Come on, down you go. Down. Come on, that's as tight as they get. Ain't got any more. Work it, work it. Okay. It's in. Okay, we're back through the magic of post-production. The bearing has already been replaced, and the new snap ring is installed. I've tapped in the inside seal, and now we're gonna pack it with schmoo. Bring on the schmoo. Oh, beautiful. It's gonna be great. And now we install the outer seal. Outer seal. and the seals oppose each other so that they do a good job of trapping this giant slug of grease between the seals. Their job is to keep all of the grease in between the seals. Not inside the motor and not outside. Just in the middle. The seal is labeled TC15357A. We got the thrust washer, thrust bearing and the main front bearing installed. We got the rear bearing, the two rear seals and the shield installed. So from this point forward here, we are just going to electronics repair mode, which is probably what you were here for in the first place, without all this greasy electromechanical stuff. So let's get ready to put the circuit board in. Right, time has passed. And I skipped ahead a little bit. I got this thing all cleaned out, and I put some silicone heat transfer compound, heatsink grease, on the MOSFETs, on the 8 MOSFETs on the backside of this board. And I've installed it, and now I'm getting ready to mix up this stuff and pot the circuit board in place. Okay, we got the pot mixed up. Great. I'm going to make sure our motor bezel is pretty flat. It's pretty good. That's good enough. I'm going to let that epoxy stand for about 10 minutes. Let the bubbles come out. Not ultra critical, but easy enough to do. This stuff from MG Chemical is what, two-hour pot time, I think. Working life of 2.5 hours. Anyhow, almost there. I think that's enough. Let's see if I can get a little more on the power supply board right here. We'll talk more about the power supply board in a little bit. I think I know what failed on the old system. Okay, that's enough. It's full. Yep. That's good. If I put any more in, it's going to leak out the stem of the motor. All right, back to the task at hand. Approximately 24 hours has passed, and my soft set epoxy is nice and firm now. That turned out beautiful. Only regret here is that I did overfill this a little bit with epoxy. Caroute's instructions do provide specific volumes or by weight to mix your epoxy at. I'm not sure if that would have helped a lot because I used a different product. They recommended a two-part thermal silicone. Anyways, it looks good. It looks really well sealed up, super firm. So I'm going to start hooking up wires and reassemble this beast and get it ready to go. The color codes are a little different There were labels on the old assembly, but I can't remove those labels. So I've just made some markings on here. This one was going to red wire, blue, and I believe this was the white wire on the stator. Yeah, WHT. So I'll get those things hooked up and we'll put some benchtop power supply on it and see if it works. Okay, so did a test run on fit up. I think we're ready to assemble. I removed the rotor, permanent magnet rotor, which is really a neat thing here. Got a bunch of magnets epoxied to the shaft. That's cool. And you can see the stator with its laminated core. It looks really good. I think the Caroute motor is really high quality. We'll talk about why it went bad just a little bit later. So I've got my wires color coded. Hopefully these all go together. One thing I really want to make sure is that I don't pull on my PCB, that if I do separate my banana connectors, that I don't just tug on the wires from the PCB. I'm sure the banana connector would release way before damaging the connection to the PCB, but I don't want to challenge the epoxy's hold on the PCB, because it's that epoxy is kind of working to keep the silicone thermal grease in contact with the motor's aluminum casing. Okay, so I think we are good to go for an assembly here. I'm going to look down into the motor and make sure that nothing is impinging on the space where the rotor's shaft will go. I got something a little bit in a bind over here. Okay, I think we're in. Yeah, those wires definitely want to push back out. So what I'll do is rotate my stack vertically to keep this thing in place. That's pretty good. And now I got to drop that rotor in. And the rotor's not great to handle because it's, of course, firstly, magnetic. And I need this spring washer and washer to stay in place, which I'm sure the grease will keep it from going anywhere. For the drop in. And we're just going to be ready for that magnetic attraction this, oh my god, holy fuck. Do not want to let it snap in there and knock the seals right out of the back of the motor. Don't think the clearances would allow me to get pinched here. I think the stator windings would gently cushion the blow. All right, so I think we're near the bottom. All right, I think I can feel it going through the, yep, we got a shaft coming out the bottom. Awesome. Okay, and I think my spring washer has bottomed out on the bottom of the casing. The rotor is standing about 2 millimeters above the laminations on the stator, so that's good. I think we're in. Great. I'm going to give myself a little application of grease along the O-ring sealing surface. Definitely more than I needed. So I can get just one single pump from the Milwaukee grease gun. Sorry for the fan noise. Absolute necessity today. I measured this grease with the ohm meter. It has really, really high dielectric property. That's cool. Because, you know, it's definitely around this low voltage DC stuff. Alright. This is goobered up. Bearing stays intact. There it is. Fasteners are already schmooed up with green goo. That's where we go. So, we wanted to talk about failure mechanisms and why I've done all of this work. And the answer is, there is a 48 volt to 12 volt converter that is a whopping 1 watt rating. By the way, that is this little piece right here. That's floating loose. That is the control power supply for this motor. And it's gone bad. So when I put voltage on it, it functions normally up until when I get to about the 32 volt range. And then the 12 volt supply fails. It breaks down and it starts putting the unregulated power through. And what's most surprising is it hasn't fried the control system on the motor controller, because when you turn the voltage, the supply voltage back down, when you get down to about 24 volts, that power supply starts working again. And it starts putting out 12.0 volts, and the motor starts right back up, like it never missed a beat. And you know, the motor doesn't even like go through a boot up sequence, so it kind of makes me feel like the 12 volt supply is only providing power to like the potentiometer for the throttle, and the signal back from the potentiometer goes out of range high because of the high voltage getting through, but not to a level that would damage the control circuit. So, as soon as the voltage gets back in spec, the motor just starts running normally again, like nothing ever happened and it never even powered off. Okay, back. This is ready to power up. I put the prop back on, and I do not have the control head plugged in right now, so I'm going to power it up without it. Good. So it doesn't give the correct tone because it recognizes that there's no, I don't know what it's expecting, 2.5K resistance at 12 volts DC because the pot is not plugged in. So I'm going to plug that in. Motor's off again. And on the boat, I'm not actually using the tiller pot. I ordered all of the parts to convert this into remote throttle from Caroute. All right, so we're plugged in. We're going to go for power up. And there's the Caroute jingle. Must be their, they got like a slogan and a little jingle or something. And so this is powered up at 32 volts again. That's the max I can do on my power supply. Well, that is great. Yeah, just running a test. Gonna let this cook for maybe a few hours. I'll let it run. It's only drawing 100 watts. Hope the garbage can holds up.
Wow, you've made it almost to the 40-minute mark. Congratulations. I tested this motor for hours. It ran perfectly. Took it to a lake and it ran brilliantly there. I'll be sure to post some new videos soon about the other boat and the drive system on it. Thanks for watching. Let me know what you think. Appreciate your time and your comments.